Today, we will be starting our electrochemistry chapter, chapter 17. And this is personally my favorite chapter that we cover this semester in Chem 152 because it is the most relevant. I want you to think about something you use every day that is not operated by a battery. And because you're in school, we have a few options. Pens and pencils and erasers tend to be the first suggestions that students offer. However, even pens are starting to be smart and have battery-operated capabilities in order to act as a smart pen. So, very applicable chapter. Our goal by the end of the chapter is to take the information we discuss and describe how we actually use it to build the real batteries that you're using. Here we have our obligatory citation of sources. And we start this chapter with a review of terminology. With electrochemistry, again, our goal in this chapter is to study batteries and to describe how they are built. To do this, we use spontaneous chemical reactions that generate electricity. So we will be using equations that go back to our thermochemistry chapter to describe spontaneity. The reactions that we are going to be studying in batteries are redox reactions. This should sound familiar. This will be a review of first semester chemistry terminology. Remember that in a redox reaction, we're describing oxidation and reduction, where one element gains electrons and another one loses those electrons. And so these two processes must happen together as one substance loses, the other substance gains. On the next slide, we will do a quick review of assigning oxidation numbers, the key ones that we need to know for this semester. If you need a more in-depth review, please refer back to section 4.2 in OpenStax to review oxidation number rules. So here's the quick list of the rules we use for oxidation numbers. The first rule is often the most forgotten. Any element in its naturally occurring state is going to have an oxidation number of zero. It hasn't gained or lost any electrons yet, and so it has a number of zero. Elements in a binary ionic compound, you already know how to assign oxidation numbers. These are assigned the same way that we identify ion charges. So recognize that magnesium chloride is still considered binary because there are only two ions or two elements in here. And so, of course, we look on our periodic table and we know that magnesium has an oxidation number of 2+, chloride, each chloride ion has an oxidation number of a -1. For rule number 3, hydrogen will usually be a +1. The exceptions to this are when it's bonded with an alkali metal. Because alkali metals would have to be a +1, that forces hydrogen to actually become the anion form, and so this would be lithium hydride. This only happens with the alkali metals, by the way. Some common examples that you could use to practice assigning oxidation numbers with hydrogen. Rule number 4, looking at oxygen, it is typically a -2 in compounds. The exception to that is in a peroxide. So hydrogen peroxide is one example. Because each hydrogen is a +1, that forces each oxygen to actually be a -1. So hydrogen and potassium peroxide are the only examples where you'll see this. Other examples to work through containing oxygen are listed here. Rule number 5 is a very commonly used one. When we have a polyatomic ion, we often need to solve for the non-oxygen element. So in all polyatomic ions, oxygen will be a -2. And so then we can set up a mathematical equation to solve for the non-oxygen element in these. We have examples on the next slide that we will work through now. So these are the examples we'll work through. In these, when you're asked to assign oxidation numbers, you want to do that for each element listed in a substance. So So here we have the elemental form of oxygen. Since it's its elemental form, that would be a zero. The same thing for iron, that is its elemental form. Notice, for example, number three, we are given the ion form of copper. So that can't be zero, that's not the elemental form. But since the charge is already given, we already know the oxidation number on that ion. So the charge matches the oxidation number. For nitrate, I'm actually going to work this one off to the side. So this is our first example of a polyatomic ion. Now in here, I want to solve for both nitrogen and oxygen. Oxygen is known. I know that oxygen is a minus two because it is the standard. It's not an exception to the rule. What I need to figure out is what is the oxidation number on nitrogen then? And to do this, we can set up an equation. So nitrogen is my X, my unknown. I have three oxygens in here. And notice that the total overall charge on this polyatomic ion adds up to a negative one. When you solve for this, you'll see that nitrogen comes out to be a plus five. And when you plug everything in, you should get an overall net charge of a minus one for nitrate. I'm going to do the same thing with the permanganate ion. So again, using the same type of setup, recognize that manganese is my unknown. I have four oxygen atoms, and that all has to add up to a minus one. So again, when I report my answer, I need to report a value for manganese and for oxygen. Well, oxygen's already known. And again, notice I'm reporting my answer as the oxidation number for each oxygen, not the total that it has in the compound. Oxygen is a minus two. When we plug everything in, we solve and realize that manganese is a plus seven. The next example I will work through is barium dichromate. That's a seven, not a two. There are two ways to approach this one. One is to set it up the same as we did before as a single mathematical equation. But I think an easier way to set this up is to recognize that this is actually an ionic compound. I have barium with a two plus charge, so I've just solved for that one. And now I know that dichromate must have a total of a two minus charge. So now I'm solving for the dichromate ion in my solution. For this setup, I would have 2x to solve for the chromium because I have two atoms in there. I have seven oxygens, and the total for this needs to be a minus two charge. And I didn't solve this one ahead of time, but chromium, we can see, so writing our answers over here, chromium would have to be a plus six, oxygen would be a minus two. Another thing to note, when we are writing oxidation numbers, note that we do include both positive and negative signs for these. Normally in math, it is assumed as a positive when there's no sign, but for oxidation numbers, we typically write them. All right, I'm going to squeeze in my other solutions here. We have hypochlorous acid. So for this one, again, we are solving for chlorine. We know that hydrogen has to be a plus one. We want to solve for chlorine, and oxygen we know is a minus two. Recognize that there's no charge listed here, meaning that it is implied to be a zero. That means all of our oxidation numbers need to add up to be zero. Therefore, chlorine has to be a plus one. We can do the same thing for SO2. Key thing again to recognize here is that this is listed as a neutral molecule. This is not an ion. There is no net charge listed up here. Sorry, that looks like a minus. Notice that there is no charge. And so when I go to solve this, oxygen is my known of a minus 2. I have two of those. Sulfur has to be a plus 4 to have everything add up to 0. And then our last example would be the sulfate ion. So notice we have a charge listed here. Oxygen is, again, my known of a minus 2. In order to solve for sulfur, I need all of my oxidation numbers to add up to a minus 2. Therefore, sulfur is a plus 6.